Hello and welcome to another episode of History Hack. My name's Beth, joining you as your co-host this afternoon with Alex. So Alex, what have we got going on today?
We've got a brilliant one today. We know how much everybody loves it when Colin comes out to play because Colin brings smashing Spanish history. So what have we had so far, Colin? We've had Don Quixote.
Yes, that's correct.
Spanish Civil War.
That's right.
Is that the two you've done? Oh, Guernica. That
and
one.
Guernica,
very,
yeah.
Very yes, popular. That
really
one.
Enjoyed that.
Yeah, and the cartoon was immensely popular as well. Yeah, because it was all Picasso themed.
It was fantastic. I think Steve is, yeah, Steve. I think he's done a fantastic job. I was just thinking that today. That man has made so many people so happy.
He has.
By doing those fantastic pictures of us.
That's pretty much the best we've ever had as well. I've only come for the cartoon, so.
I'm only here for the cartoons.
Nothing wrong with cartoons.
Anyway, Colin Fisher is an amateur historian, but my God, is he good. I'm trying to convince
him
to write a book, and he's like, nah. I'll be beating something out of him for the Great War Group. So, but he's here today because we were looking for some American tack to our history for a few episodes this month. And he said, but what if I go away and look at the Spanish-American War? So that's what we're going to do. This is really interesting. So we're going to look at basically the last big deal, or one of the last big deals for the American army before they then got embroiled in World War One, aren't we?
Exactly. And if I can't make your hair stand up on end, if I can't make the listeners stand up and cheer and boo by talking about Cuba in 1898, then I have done a very bad job, because it is an amazing story. And it's so much that hinges on it. I think that's what I've really learned from it. So if I can't convey the drama and the long-term consequences, then I'm afraid even as an amateur historian, I failed.
Then you quit. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. Because it is such an amazing story. And it's not even one that's particularly well known here in Spain. Mm. And there's no reason why it shouldn't be, because although you can argue, spoiler alert here, the Spanish don't win.
Yeah.
The some of the individuals involved and some of that, just the sheer ballsy attitudes that came out from it. There's no country could be ashamed of it. So I hope I can convey some of that. And I'm afraid, again, spoiler alerts, I'm afraid America's not going to come out too good from it.
No, they are very baby army, aren't they, at the time?
Very much. I mean, it's not as if it's an inexperienced army, but you've got this strange dichotomy between the recruits who come from every background and every race within America, but they're being led by guys that actually fought in the Civil War. So and yet it's also a very modern war. We've got armored cruisers. It's like a steampunk paradise, because it's got all these issues to do with vintage uniforms, weapons, attitudes, but it's also been done at a speed that would have been unthinkable in the Napoleonic era.
It is. So let's start right at the beginning. What does Cuba look like at this time? Talk to us about who lives there. And we've got everything from slaves on plantations, haven't we, still?
That's right. That's right. Until 1887, slavery is still legal in Cuba.
And then we've got all the way up to a Creole aristocracy.
That's right.
Tell us about Cuban society.
It's extremely divided. It's exactly as you said. So you've got this Creole aristocracy who have been there for centuries. So they are the result of intermarriage across the centuries, across racial groups. There's nothing shameful in that. They've accumulated vast amounts of wealth. And by the mid-19th century, they're not too bothered about thinking, well, if we were annexed by America, would that be such a bad thing? Because basically, we sell sugar, we sell tobacco, developing a rum industry, And our biggest growing market is America. That's a simple fact of the matter. However, where their wealth is concentrated is in the west of the western half of Cuba, and on the eastern half, it's relatively underdeveloped. So they would have seen up to the American Civil War, well, if we did actually become a part of the United States of America, where slavery is still legal, well, actually, it's going to be in everybody's interest in terms of, well, basically wealth creation and selling our main product. So you've got that part to it. At the other extreme of the spectrum, you've got slaves, and you've got them until 1887. So, as I say, the thing about that is that until the Catholic Church in mainland Spain becomes involved with this campaign against slavery, well, no one's too bothered about it. It's simply allowing these primary products of tobacco and sugar to be created and sold at enormous profit. Then you've also got a growing middle class within the western part of Cuba, who are not necessarily, in terms of, although they're kind of progressive in many of their attitudes, they're not necessarily thinking about independence. They might be thinking about in terms of autonomy. Why shouldn't Cuba have a bit more independence in terms of being able to govern itself, but not in terms of independence? And then you've got a large free peasantry as well, which, again, particularly working in the eastern half of the island, and they've got their small land holdings in which they're able to feed their family and able to have a bit of a profit in what they sell. And they're certainly very much the potential recruits to any revolutionary army that's going to talk about independence in Cuba. And then into all this mix, you've just got Spanish, because there is what's called the War of the 10 Years from the 1860s into the 1870s. That is before the period that we're talking about. And although it leads to the, can't quite call it the overall defeat of the rebels fighting for independence, they do gain, you know, a certain degree of autonomy in terms of what the island can do. And on the other hand, the Spanish government, to put the brakes on any kind of independent process, simply encourages large-scale emigration from the poorest areas of Spain, which tends to be up in the northwest, up in Galicia. So you've got this huge expansion, and it is huge in terms of first-generation Spanish settlers coming into a settled colonial country, which has almost by that stage up to sort of over three centuries of Spanish control, but in which it's taken on its own specific Cuban identity. So it's a very, very mixed country. And it's a small country. I think by the 1840s, we're talking about a population of 1.5 million. So by the 1880s, 1890s, it's not that much bigger. And if you look at the map, it's not huge either. But there's a lot being crammed into that. So by the time we're talking about the 1880s, 1890s, it's a society with a lot of potential pressure points and points where you're going to get this fracturing of Cuban society.
So looking at the Spanish, yes, it's 300 years of empire, but we're very, very much past the peak of the Spanish Empire, aren't we? So what is it look like at this time?
What it looks like is, again, this strange dichotomy, to use that word again, but it's the best one that I can think of, where you've got the first steam railway in Spain is actually built in Cuba, because it makes sense commercially to put this technology into the island. Because it's all about exporting. It's all about getting these primary goods from sugar and tobacco and then rum and getting it to the ports and getting it exported as quickly as possible. So it's, you have this extremely modern element to it. So you've got steam trains put in there before they're actually put into mainland Spain. And then you've also got the railways and the refineries becoming targets for independence movements, because they understand that if you want to get Madrid's attention, you've got to blow up some railway tracks. So by the 1880s, by the 1890s, you've got a very polarized society in which you've got a large part of the middle class talking about autonomy, but you've also got this incredibly conservative, socially and politically conservative group associated not just with the Creole aristocracy, but also with large scale mainland Spanish investment, with a lot of political parties with interests in the country as well. So the way that I would describe it is you've got Havana, very cosmopolitan, a very open city, a very dynamic city with everything going on. But as soon as you move eastwards, as you move out of that kind of metropolitan area with the refineries, with the railways, you're getting into a lot of small land holdings. And you've also then got this growing military presence where the Spanish are sending more and more troops. In terms of frontline troops, we're talking by the 1890s, 100,000 frontline Spanish troops out of an even larger army, maybe 300,000, there to support it, who are building blockhouses and trenches, because they are realizing that to control this landmass, which might not be huge, but it's big enough, you've got to divide it into military zones. You've got to stop the free movement of rebel bands. So in Havana, have a great time. It's party city. It's open. It's everything you want. But as soon as you leave that, as soon as you're traveling in the countryside, and if you're not from that peasant class, well, you're easily identifiable and you're at some risk. So it can seem very normal on the one hand that everyone is living the same way in the cities, but you actually travel out from the cities, then you're entering a very, very different landscape.
That's really a really interesting point to bring up. So obviously it's the Spanish-American War that we would reference it to, is, you know, in an English perspective. What kind of stake does America have in Cuba at this time? Is, you know, it's a large investments in the island and is the Cuba's largest market. What do they have? What stake, what interest do they have in the island?
Huge. I mean, huge. It is one of their largest markets for selling finished goods, in the same way that it is for Madrid as well. But for the Americans, it's also the fact that they are importing their tobacco and their sugar and their rum from Cuba. And it's massive. They've got copper and iron mines there. They've got large-scale investments in the railways. They're the money guys. For Madrid, it's about taxation. For the Americans, for their business interests, it's all about having an easy access to markets, and it's having an easy access to the products that they can sell at a massive profit in America. That's what it is for them. And although they're talking about, on the one hand, let's free Cuba from Spanish domination, and it kind of fits into that anti-Catholic narrative that came out in the second half in the United States, which is often tied, for example, with large-scale Irish immigration into America, associating a kind of Catholic hierarchical society with one that was the antithesis of a modern American democracy. So although they're talking about Cuba benefiting from American democracy, what they see is yet another black slave rebellion. Mm. So it's a huge racial overtones to this as well.
Yeah.
So they're not seeing the Cuban independence movement. They're not seeing its leaders como José Martí as sophisticated political leaders. What they're seeing is they're blowing up our railways. They're blowing up our refineries. So actually, all we want to do is let's get a military presence there and let's make sure that our business interests there are secure, we control the political scene, and basically the Cubans themselves, although they're fighting desperately for their independence, they're not sophisticated or sufficiently developed in terms of a culture or politics to be able to take charge of their own country. So those two things run together, those business interests and what is essentially an extremely racist attitude to what's going on in another independent country.
So yeah, this country does have, so before, we're looking at 1898 for the Spanish-American War, but 3 years before that, we do get Jose Martí and his independence movement. There is a Cuban War of Independence, isn't there?
That's right. You could say, at least you would say three in the 19th century. I mean, you had a 10-year independence struggle in the 1860s into the 1870s. You've got tobacco workers in America sending funds to the Cuban independence movement to allow them to buy arms, for example. So that's happening beforehand. And then in 1895, as you say, there's another independence uprising. And Jose Martí, he knows that he's walking a very, very fine line, because the Spanish are doing a good job at defending their last Central South American imperial possession that has remained loyal to Spain since all the independence movements of Simón Bolívar from the 1820s and so on. And they've done a good job. They've understood before the British in South Africa the importance of denying the rebels access to food, to ammunition, just to have the support of the population. So he knows, Jose Martí, that without American help, he basically cannot lead his forces to victory. But on the other hand, he knows the dangers that comes from the other side. And they've been fighting for 3 years and they've fought themselves to a standstill. There is no possibility, I think, in 1898 of a independent Cuban army taking power, because the Spanish have known that they've entrenched themselves well. They've built this whole series of blockhouses. So on the military side, they know they're controlling the situation, although they've suffered great casualties. And on the other hand, they've actually encouraged and actually made good their promises of autonomy for Cuba because of essentially a change in government in Madrid from a conservative to a liberal government. They've actually brought forward plans for autonomy, and they've got Cubans from these middle classes to take part in this, what's essentially an autonomous Cuban parliament, which is based in Havana, which by the time of the outbreak of hostilities is already sitting.
Absolutely. So that's really interesting. So both sides that become involved in this conflict, the Spanish and the Americans, they're really quite even in their level of their interference with propaganda in Cuba, aren't they? You know, what are they saying about each other, about Cuba in the wider context? Well,
again, I think that's very interesting, because our first reaction is thinking about Hearst, William Hearst, in New York, and he's in a cutthroat battle with his main competitor, Pulitzer. And he does want war, and he's prepared to get it. And he knows essentially is that if he gets war in Cuba, he's going to sell more newspapers. So we've got that image, which is very interesting. The yellow press, the New York Post and the New York Journal, I think they were. But if you travel outside of New York, if you go to the Midwest, if you go to Indianapolis, yes, you've got this split between Democrat and Republican newspapers. But what they're saying outside of New York is, yes, there is a situation there in Cuba. However, military intervention is not necessarily the answer. Now, what will be the big change will be when the American battleship, the USS Maine, blows up in Havana Harbor. And that will change many things. And that is the impetus that will now propel America into war. However, even then, they're still saying, well, let's wait to find out what was the cause of this explosion. And we'll talk about that perhaps later. But what is undeniable, and this is what is the difference between the American press and the Spanish press, is that in the American press, you've got a very, 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 very effective proper campaign from the Cuban junta in New York, who are sending out their representatives to Indianapolis, to the cities in Pennsylvania, who understand, unless we get our message out to the American people outside of the big cities, we're not going to get governmental support. So, as I say, on the one hand, you've got Hearst. On the other hand, you've got these small independent newspapers in the Midwest. But the other thing is, they don't have foreign correspondents. So if they're going to rely for their foreign news on, for example, the AP, Associated Press, that is coming via Hearst. And so these stories of atrocities that are being propagated around America, they are appearing regularly in these small town newspapers. Now, if you go over to Spain and you look at what they're writing, it's two different worlds. It's unbelievable the lack of detailed political, military insight that these newspapers have. It's a hysteria that has taken over. In Madrid, they set up a bullfight, but with an elephant. They have a bull and they have an elephant, because the elephant represents America. That's what they've chosen. And so they have the bull attacking the elephant. And that's reported. That's the main news that's being passed around, that Spain can overcome America. Mm-hmm. I think that where the biggest area is that's hysteria takes over is their reporting on the Spanish fleet, in which they genuinely believe that the Spanish Atlantic fleet that they're going to send out will be enough to take on the American fleet. There's just no two ways. There's not one question of doubt about that. I think the other thing that's interesting is that the Spanish press do never pick up on the popular resistance to sending soldiers out to Cuba, because it's basically a conscript army that's being sent out, largely illiterate. It's from the poorest sections of society. If you've got 1,500 pesetas, you can buy your way out, but there's very few families that have that access to that kind of money, and those that do get themselves into huge amounts of debt. The Spanish army finally prohibits the families of the recruits that are being sent to Cuba coming along to the railway stations and the ports, because what they're doing is protesting. In Barcelona, they lie down on the railway tracks, the mothers of the recruits.
Oh, wow.
So you do have these quite clear signs that not is all well in Spain's military preparation, but you'll be impossible to find one newspaper report, including the left-wing press, which was large at that time, who have decided, yes, we are going to lose, but we shouldn't annoy the military. We shouldn't give them an excuse to get involved in any kind of coup. We shouldn't be seen as anti-patriotic. So even the left-wing press do not get involved in any demonstration of basically, we're not ready for this.
So we've got Spanish patriotism, Cuban independence, and American imperialism all about to explode on this little island. We've mentioned some of the politics behind getting the troops there, but how are they tooled up is what we need to know next, don't we? This is kind of like, so the American Civil War is the birth of sort of industrial warfare, but we're not going to see it on the scale that we are in 15 years after this. So we're somewhere in the middle. So what does fighting look like?
Again, as befits any topic to do with Spain, it's extremes.
Okay.
So if we look at the Spanish military, they are made up of this conscript army with very, very basic training, who don't have shoes, who in the last weeks of peace before outbreak of war are sending messages from this high command asking for underwear. So large numbers of Spanish soldiers, frontline soldiers, don't have shoes and they don't have underwear and they don't have food. Because by the time we get to the conflict, the poor level of rations are even worse because you've got an American blockade. So this is what you've got on the Spanish side. You've also got just that sheer bloody mindedness of any Spanish military unit. When they decide to not budge, they will not budge. You've got an officer corps that has got 20, 30 years experience on that individual level. You've got, I'll talk about a guy called Baradere later on, but you've got guys that have enlisted up when they're in their late teens and they have had experience of warfare. They have experience of leading men. And then you've got a high command that is very aware that their relationship with the politicians is what matters. So you've got that separation of interests. Now, in terms of weapons, these bootless Spanish conscripts who
have got awesome guns, haven't they?
They've got Mausers.
Yeah.
They have got the best rifle of the period. They don't have automatic weapons. They've got mountain artillery with smokeless charges. And that's going to be very, very important. So they don't have anything over, what would it be, about 75 millimeters. They don't have siege weapons. But when they open fire, the enemy don't know where they're coming from because they're using smokeless cartridges. And they do know how to use them. They're not incompetents. They've divided Cuba into a series of military zones controlled by blockhouses, controlled by a system of trenches. They do have enough communication. They're using heliographs. So they are able to communicate using mirrors across long distances. The system works. Now, if you go to the Spanish Navy, before the arrival of the Atlantic Fleet, you've got basically slightly upgraded coastal monitors.
When you say Spanish Navy, to me, I'm still looking at the Armada in my head. I don't ever advance beyond a wooden ship in my head.
They had advanced by then, and they had developed their skills. The problem was they hadn't invested enough. So they've got capital ships, and they've got armoured cruisers. They've got this substantial hardware. They're waiting on cruisers coming from British shipyards. They've got destroyers, which at that time are basically large-scale torpedo boats. They've got them. And the Spanish have as much of a naval heritage as, let's just say, the British Navy at that time. They've been navigating the world since the 1490s. So they've got all this behind them. But they've not had the investment to look after their ships. I think that's the difference. Cervera, the Spanish admiral that's ordered to take the fleet over to Cuba, he says, look, my guns don't fire. The hulls are fouled. We're simply not ready. But if you order me to go, I'm going to go. But I'll tell you now that it's going to make no difference and you're going to lose the Atlantic Fleet. Now, let's go over to the Americans.
Yeah, and similar contradictions, aren't there? Not quite as extreme.
Yeah, they do have the more than the foundation of their world fleet, let's say, you know, in terms of let's now project our power beyond the Caribbean, the West Coast. Shortly before the Spanish-American War, they've annexed Cuba. So we're talking about this change when McKinley takes over and America is becoming this pseudo-imperial power. So they've got modern ships in the Navy, but they're not going to really fight the war. It's going to be the army. Now, the army is simply not ready. They're not ready in terms of equipment, and they're not ready in terms of their leadership, and they're not ready in terms of their war goals. McKinley is a strong presidential figure. He's got a weak cabinet, but he's doesn't mean that he knows why he's got into Cuba. But he's going into Cuba in a very strong, dynamic way. He just doesn't actually know exactly what it is that he wants to achieve. So apart from the Navy, I just don't see any of them being ready. The generals like Schaffner are all Civil War era. They've got Confederate generals, generals that fought on the other side. And in fact, in one of the first opening battles, skirmishes, the ex-Confederate general, as he leads his men against the Spanish troops just off Guantanamo Bay, he's shouting at them, "Look, boys, we've got the Yankees on the run." So you've got these attitudes that have come from the 1860s. We're talking about the 1880s now, 1890s. When you look at the weapons, they are far, far, far behind anything the Spanish have got. They're using black powder charges in their artillery. Their rifles are Winchesters. And this is something which the Spanish realize very early on. We know where they are because we can see them. Their uniforms, they're wearing those blue serge uniforms, which are suited for North America, but they're not suited for Cuba. They've also got logistic problems. I mean, the Spanish don't have it easy, but at least they've got internal lines of communication. They've got one railway line down to Tampa Bay in Florida, which is the point of departure for the Spanish, for the American forces. And it breaks down. When they land in Guantanamo Bay, they don't have everything they need. I mean, this is a large-scale operation. And they're simply not ready. They might have the battleships, but they don't have the supply ships. And there's arguments about what should be unloaded. And it takes a long time to get all of this sorted out. However, what the Americans do have are four Gatling guns. And those Gatling guns are going to change everything. Mm-hmm. Now, this is another example of technology. But it's American sort of Civil War technology, which will actually make a huge difference in 1898. We're not talking about Maxim machine guns.
Yeah.
We're talking about Gatlings. We're talking about hand-cranked machine guns.
These are the ones where you have to wind them round to get them to carry
Yes, yes, yes. But they work.
Yeah.
For the Americans and the Spanish, as you've said, there are definitely problems with their technology. What actually is their, I know you've briefly mentioned it, but what's their leadership like? What's the organisation like? Do they have good generals, good admirals, and a lower level, like a junior officer level?
Well, I think if we talk about the Americans, you've got a White House that insists that they have telephone and telegraph lines directly into the American field headquarters.
Mm, that's
so
mad.
We want to know 24 hours a day what's going on.
This is something quite special for the president to be able to ring HQ.
It's the first time.
Yeah.
It's the first time directly from the White House. So they're getting status reports every day. General Schaffner, on the other hand, who is the American commander in charge of land forces, he shouldn't be there. He shouldn't be there. One reason being he's from that American Civil War generation. And another reason is he is going to almost die from illnesses that he picks up when he's there. He's already asthmatic. He's already obese. He struggles to get onto a horse. He doesn't know how to impose leadership. Throughout the campaign, he issues orders, but he doesn't follow up. So you get down to the middle level, I think, in the American forces. And I think this would be perhaps something that, again, would be very similar within the Spanish military, is that those leaders on the ground are able to inspire their men. And not just the regular military, but we're talking about the militias that came too. Probably the most well-known one would be Theodore Roosevelt's Rough Riders.
Yeah.
And he will play a pivotal role. It's one of these moments where you take one individual out of this equation and it will make a huge difference, as it will on the Spanish side. So I think on that middle level, you've got men capable of inspiring leadership. And I think in terms of the brigade level within the American military, you've got capable commanders, but they don't trust each other.
Yeah.
They don't coordinate. I mean, one, it's difficult to coordinate in the era before radio, but they simply don't trust each other. And I don't think they necessarily get on with each other. And I think there's this definite lack of what are we actually here to achieve? Yes, we do have to take San Juan Hill. That's fair enough. But actually, what do we do after that? What you've also got in the American military is a logistical system that, although it breaks down at the beginning, does begin to function later on. You've got officers there that are able to load and unload a ship. You've got engineers that can repair railroads. So in terms of how do we get everything our men need at the front, yes, we can do it. On the naval side, you've just basically got an extremely professional naval force, but riven by personal differences. So Admiral Sampson is the overall leader. On the day of the Battle of Santiago de Cuba, he's absent. He's going off to meet up with General Schaffner. And although it leads to an American victory, and he's not there, he's pretty pissed off. Mm. And he definitely wants to have his name put there as the leader of the American forces that led to the defeat of the Spanish fleet. So you've got those cracks there on the American side. On the Spanish side, on the platoon level, or up to the brigade level, slightly below, you've got men that just say, we stay, we fight, and we hold. Beyond that, you've got the guys that are getting the telegrams from Madrid, sending contradictory reports, and they're trying to make the best of a bad situation. But they know that they cannot rely on getting support from their political leaders. So you've got the kind of governor general in Havana, a guy called Blanco, and he's full of optimism, and he says, I would rather, see the end, give up my life before giving up Cuba. So he ends up giving up Cuba, but he seems to hold on to his life at the end of it. He's not going to be too damaged by this. You've got under him General Linares, who's not a bad commander, that does end up being wounded. And you've got... But who is hampered by a sense of caution, who's hampered by not just knowing what's over the hill. He doesn't have full intelligence reports in the way that the Americans do working with Cuban rebels. And then you've got men like Barra de Rey, who is a career officer. He's 57 years old. He is fighting with his two brothers. He's fighting with his two sons and one of his brothers there in the front line. He's there at the San Juan Hill and at Caney, which are the two principal battles. And when he draws his sword, he never puts it back in its sheath. He is one of those leaders who never has to fire a weapon, but he is there in the front line. He's got 500 men under his command. There are 5,000 Americans at the bottom of the hill, and he does not yield. He will not budge. He has overridden General Linares' instructions, because General Linares doesn't understand. He didn't understand fully. You don't build a blockhouse, your defences on the top of a hill.
Yeah.
You build it slightly below, because that cuts out the dead ground that an attacking force can use at the bottom of a slope. And he set up fields of fire. That's what he's done. And the Americans walk into it. And Barra de Rey, he's got a statue here in Spain. I think he was from the Canary Islands. But he's totally unknown and it's totally undeserved. The man was a hero. They shattered both his legs. He was on a stretcher and he was still commanding the last 90 Spanish soldiers holding Caney against 5,000 American soldiers for 12 hours.
That is insanity. I want to ask you, this point is perfect for this question. Do we see, and as a British person I can say this, the typical white man's arrogance about fighting people with different colour skin? So do the Americans look down their nose at Hispanic officers?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. They expect the campaign, which was very rapid. But for example, they expect the campaign to be over in a couple of days. They expect to take San Juan Hill and Caney in 2 hours. Basically, manoeuvre their forces, advance in line, first line fire, second line advances through, and so on, and you'll march up those hills. They don't have any artillery support. They didn't bring any siege artillery, and the artillery which they did bring is black powder. So those cannons are knocked out. Because the Spanish see them coming.
They're expecting to spot them aside, aren't they?
Beg your pardon?
Not also tell the Cubans they don't need them.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. The Cubans who have fought for 3 years are just, they are used as, not even as reconnaissance troops. They are, you know, if you can get some information, that's great. But basically, we'll get this sorted. And this is what José Martí was scared about. At the end of the campaign, Galixto García, who is the other main commander in the eastern part of the island, who is working with the Americans, when it comes to the takeover of Santiago de Cuba, which is the center of the American offensive, he just says, I'm not taking part anymore. I'm telling my men to go home. Because you have made it clear that we are not welcome. They won't fly the Cuban flags of independence. It's all stars and stripes. And it's clear from the comments by all officers, including junior officers, just simply racist attitudes towards particularly the Cubans. The Spanish, they do realize very quickly in both the naval engagement in Santiago de Cuba and in San Juan Hill, and at the Caney, is that they've been up against a determined, well-trained, disciplined military force. And they allow them all the military honours. They allow them to the officers to march out with their sidearms. The Spanish fleet that sails out from Santiago de Cuba is defeated. But the prisoners, including Admiral Cervera, are well treated, honoured as well. So because of the resistance which the Spanish put up, there's respect. Towards the Cuban rebels, there's absolutely nothing whatsoever. And you look, this is what I was saying before about the impact about this conflict. And remember, it's also part of a broader conflict that takes in the Philippines and takes in Puerto Rico. Mm. You can see the line now that goes from 1898 up to the Bay of Pigs. It's exactly the same. There's no idea of allowing political institutions to develop by Cubans and for Cubans, given the vast variety of experiences and attitudes within Cuban society. But there's never an idea that we can simply allow the Cuban independence movement to fulfill its goals and to allow Cuba to develop as an independent country. And I think that just plagues American-Cuban relations from 1898 up to, as I say, up to the Bay of Pigs and possibly beyond.
Mm. Yeah. So obviously you've mentioned a lot of really interesting things that happened during this war, and we've talked about technology and the leadership as well. Another factor that seems to be throughout history and throughout conflicts, a really important point is the impact of illness as well. So what kind of impact do illnesses have on Spanish and the Americans? Is there anything that particularly causes more problems than anything else? Are either side unprepared for the kind of diseases they would be encountering?
The Spanish suffered, and they suffered greatly, but they knew what they were getting into because they'd been there for 300 years. Mm. So you've got yellow fever, you've got typhus, you've got diphtheria, and you've got the black sickness, which is basically just what it says. You end up, your vomit is black and you die from the inside out. There's nothing nice about it. In terms of the casualties, you're talking maybe less than 10% directly related to battles. Mm. The ones that really suffer are the Americans. They do have an idea. Their medical staff are warning them from the start, but because of the logistical problems, they don't have enough medical equipment and medical staff on Cuba from the beginning of the campaign at the landing in Guantanamo Bay. Now, it's one of these, unfortunately, say it, ifs in history. Given the resistance the Spanish put up at San Juan Hill and El Caney, where they hold up as a total, I mean, on the Caney, where Barra de Rey was, 5,000 Americans, the total force must have been about 10,000. If the Spanish reserves in the city of Santiago de Cuba had been released, if Schaffner had, as he proposed, pulled back his forces about 5 miles, he didn't actually think that he'd won enough to hold it. And if the Spanish had just counterattacked, if they just held the approaches to the hills or whatever, the level of illness within the American forces could have forced an American withdrawal. I'm not saying a defeat, because I think in the end, the result would have been the same. But the American military medical service were saying, look, unless you get these guys out of Cuba and find a place in America that is away from any urban settlement, you have got a plague on your hands. That is what you've got. The rate of infection is huge. Between malaria, yellow fever, the black vomit, between, as I say, diphtheria, typhus, the whole lot. Unless you get these frontline troops out now, you have got a problem. Mm, as funny. It is, General Linares didn't release those reserves. So it is a case where, given the conditions that these soldiers were facing, sickness and illness did have a huge impact and could have had an even a massive impact in terms of the Americans just saying, we have to pull back for 24 hours. That 24 hours would become 48, would become 72, and it would just have carried on. The result would have been the same, but it would have been much longer than the campaign that was there. And just simply the huge number of American casualties of men that never saw combat, weren't near the front line, but died through sickness.
Still that in World War One, to be honest with the Americans. But yeah, Let's talk about clashes. You've mentioned his name already, San Juan Hill. Spanish put up a stinking great resistance, but it's Teddy Roosevelt's moment of glory, isn't it?
Absolutely. And you can't call it anything else. Mm. It was a moment of glory. It is one of those pivotal moments in human history where one person can make a difference. You know, he was, I think it was Assistant Secretary of State to the Navy, gives that up, forms the Rough Riders. So you're basically a volunteer, you're paying your own way. I mean, it's all a bit of bravado in a way, but the story is he he hijacks a ship. Because I say the logistical services weren't that great on the American side. So he basically hijacks a ship and takes not even all his force, but he takes some of his force over. So so on the day of the battle, you've got a stalled American attack. That's basically what it is. You have got upwards of 10,000 men that do not know what to do, that are pinned down, where the junior officers are waiting for orders, and the orders aren't coming. There's nothing coming from Schaffner apart from the general order of attack. And every time any American force moves, and this is after that sort of general advance forward, we're talking about isolated units out of communication with each other, far less the American command. And every time they move, they get shot at. They put up an observation balloon at the start of the battle, and the Spanish took their Mausers out and shot it. That was it. That was the end of the American reconnaissance. The Spanish sharpshooters get themselves up trees. They've got a whole series of bird calls to communicate with each other. So we're talking about sniping on a very, very effective level. The artillery has been knocked out. And you are attacking an entrenched enemy position where you can't actually see anything because there's no smoke from the gunfire. All you know is that every time you move, you are seeing your men being killed and the casualties are mounting. Now, he's been leading the Rough Riders. He's the only one left on a horse, talking about Roosevelt. And he's at the bottom of San Juan Hill. And the momentum is changing. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. But he basically draws his sword like Barra de Rey and says, we're going to take that hill. Follow me. And he alone heads up that hill. He doesn't know if the rest are going to follow him. You cannot fault on either of the two armies. You cannot fault that level of guts and bravery on both sides. But on the Spanish side, the difference is we can't win, but we're not leaving. On the American side,
the last war in history where you could do that without just getting mown down by machine gun fire as well, isn't it?
Exactly, exactly. I mean, Mausers are good, but they're not automatic. Now, if the Spanish had one automatic weapon up on one of those hills, that also could have changed it. Because we've talked about Teddy Roosevelt, and you cannot deny that the myth that surrounds that man is actually based on fact. You cannot take that away from him. Whether or not he should have been there in the first place, but the man had...
That's why he's riding around on a horse in a night at the museum. It's supposed to be that.
Yes, it's him. And that's the way he's dressed.
Yeah.
And why does he survive when everyone, other people around him had been shot down? But him with his sword, he revives the spirits of his men and they renew the assault. They do have a bit of artillery, and as again back to the technology, the Cuban rebels who they've been disparaging do have a dynamite gun, which is fascinating in itself. Because we've talked about the problem with black powder, but black powder has a good thing that it won't actually blow up the shell in the barrel. How do you use high explosive to fire a shell and not blow it up? And there was this technology called the dynamite gun, which is you use an explosive charge to build up air pressure in a chamber, and it's the air pressure that throws the projectile forward. So that's actually the one piece of artillery that the Americans do have, and it is effective against the Spanish defences. But what makes a difference is that, again, talking about leadership on the ground, when you have a general like Schaffner that is not able to direct any battle from even hour to hour, not far less minute to minute, are the four Gatling guns. They're not considered as offensive weapons. They're considered as defensive weapons. They're there to defend the artillery. Now, the artillery's been knocked out. So there are four Gatling guns, and I'm not entirely sure who. It may have been the commander of the section himself, or someone orders the three of those Gatling guns up the front line, because you know the pictures of Gatling guns. They're pieces of artillery. They're on a wheeled carriage. And those three Gatling guns are brought up to San Juan Hill and the Caney. And they devastate the Spanish defences because they do traverse. Although they are hand cranked, they do traverse. And they simply traverse along the Spanish parapets. And although the Spanish defenders have been hidden from the attacking forces, the combined fire of those three Gatling guns means the Spanish cannot put their heads up.
This is essentially the last scene of the Last Samurai, isn't it? This is what happens to the samurai.
Yes, this is it. This is a kind of, you almost want, one hand it is the 20th century coming home to roost in terms of military technology, but yeah. Technology from the 1860s.
Yeah.
Being used for maybe effectively the first and last time before the era of belt-fed machine guns.
Yeah.
And it just simply means that these isolated units, American units, waiting for orders, the officers can say, right, now we attack. Even then, the Spanish will not budge. They will not move.
You've got disaster in the Bay of Santiago de Cuba, haven't you?
Oh, only the Spanish. And I say that with so much affection and so much love. Only the Spanish could sail a fleet out to certain death and do so with all flags flying and all the officers in dress uniform. And with the leading admiral being gallant to such a degree, you think Hollywood wrote the script. Words almost fail you. Cervera is the Spanish admiral who was ordered by the government in Madrid to take the Atlantic fleet out. And if I say what he sent in a telegram, it kind of sums up what he thought. Con la conciencia tranquila, voy al sacrificio. With my conscience at peace, I go to the sacrifice. And he says that from the beginning. I am not coming back. They managed to get out across to Puerto Rico. The Americans never really know where they are. And it's a kind of, basically, where do I go? And he gets the Spanish fleet into the harbour in Santiago de Cuba.
Yeah.
He gets there in June 1898. Now, Santiago de Cuba, it's a fantastic harbour. I mean, it's impossible to enter. And it's impossible to leave. It is the worst place for any fleet that is hoping to attack to leave from. The capital ships can only leave one at a time. So you can't even get that sheer sort of physical force of the fleet leaving to take the Americans by surprise. The Americans are good. They blockade all the ports very, very effectively. They do it 24 hours a day. They use searchlights as well. At night, they try and block the entrance using a coal ship called the Merrimack, which almost does it, but the Spanish basically knock its engine out before they can block the channel. But basically, they're rats in a trap.
Yeah.
So they basically linger there. They send the sailors out to take part in the land battles. They then get the sort of final order. You have to do something. That's what Cervera is told. He has a conference with his officers and they realise, yes, they are going to have to take on a superior force, a much more superior force. Now, Cervera is a good man. There's no two ways about it. He's got a shit job. You know, basically, this is the full stop to the end of Spanish presence in Central and South America. And he's going to have to do it with a degree of glory that will save some pride for the nation. But he does make mistakes. Bustamante is the second in command, and he dies in the land battles. But before he does that, he says two things. So we are going to have to leave the harbour of Santiago de Cuba. Two things. One, we send the two destroyers out first, and they just fire torpedoes. Doesn't matter where. Just a spread of torpedoes, and they just seed panic and chaos in the American fleet. Because torpedoes, even at that stage, were actually more effective than the capital guns. So that's the first thing that he says. The second thing he says, although we've got these armoured cruisers, there's far too much wood in them. Get rid of all the wood. And this will make a huge difference, as hopefully I can explain. Now, two great bits of advice, and Cervera doesn't take either of them. It's as if he's so consumed with his own doom and honour, and this is the end, that he doesn't see that actually he could have taken the fight to the Americans. So anyway, steam up. The Americans, even though, I mean, steam up means you've got to get the boilers up to pressure. That means burning coal, which has been at a premium, but you've got to burn it. And that means that you've got smoke coming out the funnels. The Americans are still largely caught by surprise. But he doesn't send out the destroyers, first of all. And he doesn't get rid of all the wood on board. But what they do make sure is that all the officers are wearing their dress uniform. You have to be taken out by a pilot. You can't leave Santiago de Cuba without a pilot because of the channel and because of the mines that were there. Mm. And it is, again, it's straight from this idea of Spanish pride and sort of Spanish innate nobleness. And he says goodbye to his pilot because they're coming under fire. He says to the pilot, when can I turn to starboard? The pilot says, Admiral, you can turn now. He says, the Admiral says, thank you so much for your help. I think it's probably best that you leave now. And off goes the pilot. Without one word of tension, panic, fear, or anything. So the Spanish fleet sails out. And basically, it's every man for himself. Now, these are capital ships on both sides.
Yeah.
They've got heavy caliber weapons. You know, they've got cannons at, you know, 21 centimetres. Problem with gun control in the 1890s is that there isn't any. There is no gun control. There is no observation. You don't watch for the fall of shot. You don't try and straddle. It all comes down to the guy pulling the cord on the gun. So, and that's on both sides. So we're talking about a level of accuracy of less than 5% on the American side. They've got these amazing capital ships, but they can't actually hit anything with them. Right? But what they do have are the smaller caliber weapons, and they've got a faster rate of fire. And they're still certainly on the Spanish side. You look at the cruiser Vizcaya, and it's basically broadsides. You've got these 57 millimeter cannons arranged in broadside fashion, i.e. They can't traverse very much. They're at the deck level. And you've got that on the American side too. I'm not sure if any Spanish ships are sunk, but they're all set on fire. And they're all set on fire because they're filled with wood. So it's all these smaller caliber weapons that are impacting on the Spanish ships. And they're causing fires that go out of control. And the Spanish ships, within about 2 hours of leaving, and it's not that they don't fire back, but within 2 hours of leaving the port, they're all beached, all of them. The whole Spanish Atlantic fleet is lost, completely lost. Cervera survives. He is rescued by his own men. And as I said before, the American Navy could not have been more generous in the way that they treated the Spanish prisoners. Although I do find it slightly weird is that within about an hour of losing the whole Atlantic fleet, Admiral Cervera is sitting down to have lunch with the American Admiral. As I say, when you talk about Spanish history, it's always, always a matter of extremes.
So you've mentioned, Colin, that you can see, even today, from a direct line from this war, the Spanish-American War, all the way up to the Bay of Pigs. In a nutshell, what do you think is the long-term impact of this war?
In Cuba, I would say it comes down to a half century of botched up American presence in the country. And a society that was never allowed to develop along its own lines. So that was, and in the end, leading to a strong love-hate relationship between the two countries. That's what I would feel. In America, it allowed in the short term massive industrial expansion, the creation of wealth beyond anyone's imagination, and creating a mythology about the early American neo-imperial world, which is based essentially on improving the lots of oppressed people around the world, if they would just embrace American democratic systems. On the Spanish side, you have an amnesia that hits in very quickly. Despite all the press and its support towards the Spanish fight in Cuba, it just isn't mentioned. It's just gone. It's you've got this massive military and political loss, and yet it's never mentioned. And even today, you'll work hard to find any reference to it, or statues, or history books about this incredibly important conflict. At the time, you have an inward-looking society, because apart from the growing North African interests, all of the Spanish Empire is gone. So you have you do have this cultural flowering with people such as Miguel Unamuno. You've got the Machado brothers. You've got this incredible flowering of what you can call Castilian poetry, i.e. from the center of Spain. It's sort of Spanish with extra Spanishness. And it is stunning. It leads to so much that is good and positive. But on the other hand, you've got a political system that has failed, has completely, utterly failed. And no matter how much, in this case, the prime minister is called Sagasta, and he stays in power. I mean, he's lost Cuba, but he stays in power. Linares, wounded, comes back and continues to ascend in the military hierarchy. Cervera becomes head of the Navy. So, but despite all that, you've got another example where Spanish civic and political institutions have failed. They have clearly failed in what they've done. They did not support the fight in Cuba on behalf of Spain. And that's going to simply reinforce this idea of turnismo. So one party is in power, then you have another, which on one hand is very democratic, but it's basically, well, we've had our 5 years, it's your turn now, and then we'll come back in power after 5 years. And that creates a complacency that it's all about just taking control of the parliament in Madrid, and you're not addressing any of the underlying problems that are growing in Spain, and you've got a military that is still pretty large and is still looking for a role and is still innately conservative, and they've just lost their last imperial possessions. So what do you do with them? And in the short term, you send them off to North Africa. But that is very short term. And I think if we're talking about sort of lines of trajectory that connect different ages, I think the failure of the Spanish defense in Cuba, the political failure, you can again draw that line from the summer of 1898 to the summer of 1936, because you've got a military that cannot accept that Spain is no longer an imperial power, but is no longer at the center of a strong, vibrant Catholic society that represents eternal values, and they cannot accept that the world is changing around them. And they've got evidence that you cannot trust the politicians, quite clear evidence that you cannot trust them. So I think for each of the countries involved, the long-term effects were different, but all of the long-term effects were extremely negative.
Colin, once again, it's been an absolute joy to have you on talking about Spanish.
Thank you.
Bring so much passion to it. And every time you turn up, you just blow us away, which is why we keep having you back.
You're our
Spanish correspondent now. That was outstanding. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me. I always enjoy it.
Don't forget that we do exist on Patreon as History Hack and on Patreon as well, which is Podbean's own version. Elena and I have had massive fun doing this in 2020, but life's going to change quite a lot next year and we're going to actually have to go and earn a living, etc. If we want to keep up the regularity that we've been bringing you and the kind of guests that we've been bringing you and the workload, then we will need your help. So if you join, there's going to be incentives for joining on either of those platforms. We're revamping ourselves on both of them. So don't forget to go in. You can do as little as a dollar a month and it all goes towards keeping up History Hack as regular as we've been able to bring it to you this year.
When our guests join us to talk about their work and their new book, the 45 minutes or so they spend with us is just a taster of all their efforts. So to this end, we have launched our very own bookshop on bookshop.org. where you can find our guests' latest and greatest books. You can support them and you can support History Hack too. 10% of every sale via our bookshop supports the podcast and allows us to keep at it and bring you more amazing guests. You can find our bookshop at bookshop.org/shop/hackhistory or just search on bookshop.org for us under the shops bit. Thank you for your continued support and here's to your next great book.